wonderful way to begin our time of worship. That's a lot harder than some of you probably think it is. I would never try to attempt that. They just do a wonderful job. I want to remind you that if you have a prayer request, if you would fill out a prayer slip and hand it to the ushers when they collect it during the first hymn, it would be wonderful. Don't forget to sign up for Lily's. There isn't an insert in your bulletin, but there's a number of these forms over by the office door. So just be sure, and the deadline is next Sunday. So the cost of each lily is $10, so please fill that out. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday, and we hope all our children will be here because we'll be bringing in the palms, and it's just always a wonderful time when the children bring in the palms and lay them at the foot of the cross for us. And your Holy Week events are listed in the newsletter. Remember that Monday of Holy Week, a week from tomorrow, is our turn to host the service and the lunch. They're at 12:05, so I hope a lot of you'll be here to help be hosts together for that service. And also on Easter Sunday, we'll have an Easter egg hunt following worship. Let us now stand for our greeting.
The time is coming, and now is.
Time for love, time for hope.
Time for mercy, time for faith.
Time for worship, time for prayers.
Time for singing, time for praise.
The time is coming, and now is.
Come, it is time to worship.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you.
Let us remain standing for our affirmation of faith, which is the Apostles' Creed, found on page 881 in your hymnal. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our psalm for today is Psalm 51. It is found on page 785 in the hymnal, and we will be singing response 2. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love.
According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions.
Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin.
For I love my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me.
Against you, you only have I sinned and done that which is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence and blameless in your judgment.
Behold, I was born into iniquity, and I have been sinful since my mother conceived me.
Behold, you desire truth in the inward being. Therefore, teach me wisdom in my secret heart.
Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow.
Make me hear with joy and gladness. Let the bones which you have broken rejoice.
Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities.
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me.
Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me.
Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain me in me a willing spirit.
Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you.
Deliver me from death, O God, God of my salvation, and my tongue will sing aloud to your deliverance.
O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth shall show forth your praise.
For you have no delight in sacrifice. Were I to give a burnt offering, you would not be pleased.
The sacrifice acceptable to God is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. O God, you will not despise.
May be seated. The Old Covenant today is from the book of Jeremiah, the 31st chapter, verses 31 through 34, can be found in our Pew Bible on page 680. Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. not like the covenant which I made with their fathers when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. My covenant, which they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant which I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it upon their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And no longer shall each man teach his neighbor and each his brother, saying, Know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Come down at this time. A transformer, isn't it? Yeah, we talked about that a couple weeks ago. I'm sorry. Okay, what have I got? A present, a beautifully wrapped package. And there may be a gift inside, or this may be just something Sarah does to tease you. I don't know. Anyway, do y'all like to get gifts and presents? Yeah, it's fun, isn't it? I can't imagine that anyone would say they didn't like getting a gift. What was the best gift you've ever received? Can you think? What? Your trampoline?
Jesus.
Jesus. You know what I'm saying here. You know what's going on.
God.
Anything else? Okay. A lot of different things. People say different things that they like. They might get a tricycle, bicycle, whatever. But I'm going to talk about, and you guys have hinted at it, the greatest gift ever given. And that's the gift of eternal life. It's the gift of God, and it was given to anyone who wants to receive it. In the Bible, in the Gospel according to John, it says, For God so loved the world that he gave his only, one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. When the Bible says that whoever believes in him, that's you and me. That's us. God gave the gift of Jesus Christ to us, gave us the gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ to us. And even though there's lots of great gifts in this world, this is probably the greatest gift. You know, if somebody asked me what's the greatest gift I got, I'd probably say a trip or something, you know, that somebody gave me. But really, when we get down to it, the greatest gift is eternal life that we have through Jesus Christ. Now, when someone gives you a gift, it's not really polite to ask them, how much did that cost? Though sometimes I do, but I shouldn't do that. I only ask my mother that, you know. The Bible tells us how much God's gift cost, and that cost was great. The cost God gave his only Son. So just think about how much God must love us to send his one and only Son to earth to die on a cross, because we're going to start talking, we're talking about that now because we're getting ready for Easter, so that we could have eternal life. Now, there's probably a lot in there that you don't quite understand. Guess what? There's a lot in there that adults don't quite understand, too. But what we do is we believe it because we have faith. We have faith in God. Just think about how much Jesus must have loved us to be willing to die on that cross that we could have eternal life in heaven. It's a lot to think about. And I just want you to have that in your head so as you get older and learn more things, that you'll go, yeah, I now get it. I'm getting it. We're on a journey our whole life learning about Jesus, about God, about our walk, our faith. I'm still reading books and studying. The more I study, the more I realize I don't know. There's more things to find out. But in a way, this is very simple. All we have to do to receive this wonderful gift of eternal life is to believe and accept Jesus as our Savior. That's all we really have to do. All these fancy people have written all this stuff, but all we have to do is receive and believe and accept. Let us pray. Thank you, God, for the greatest gift of all. Thank you for Jesus, who loved us so much that he paid the price for our sin to give us the gift of eternal life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, y'all can go sit down. There really is nothing in there, so don't think I cheated you or anything, okay? Thank y'all. I have several prayer requests to share with you before we go to our time of prayer. The first is a praise. After everything Rowena Charlton has been through in the last few months, she celebrated her 95th birthday yesterday, surrounded by her family. Barbara gave that to us, and I know they're listening to us on the radio. So praise God. That's just wonderful. Thank you, Barbara, for sharing that. Chris would like us to keep her mother, Linda Harold, in our prayers for her blood pressure to be okay so she can have her foot surgery on Tuesday. She was supposed to have it several weeks ago, but she's had some blood pressure issues. So please keep her in your prayers. And Paulette and Ricky have asked for prayers for Charlie, their son. A lot of changes going on in his life right now, so they lift him up in prayer. And then the Tamuras have asked us to be in prayer for the victims of the bridge collapse in Florida. That I know a lot of you have seen that on the news, so we want to keep that in our prayers. Also, continue to pray for Sissy Henley and all those anonymous prayers that we have on our hearts. Let us go to God in prayer at this time. Almighty God, When we forget your name written on our hearts, have mercy on us, loving God. When we forget your law of love engraved in our lives, have mercy on us, loving God. When we neglect your spirit living in and through each of us, have mercy on us, loving God. When we ignore your beauty brightening and glorifying our lives, have mercy on us, loving God. Shine in us and through us, God of light and love, that we may remember this truth. You are our God, and we are your people, a people of mercy and love. Thank you, dear God, for creating a clean heart in us, your dear children. In your name, we are forgiven and made new in your love. Praise your holy name. We pray this in the names we have mentioned out loud and on our hearts, in the name of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, the greatest gift, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Would the ushers and the acolyte come forward to receive our morning offering? I want to let you all know that in the hymn we sing after the doxology, we're only singing four verses of it, just four verses. If you sing the fifth, you'll be doing a solo with no music. Let us pray. Dear God, engrave these gifts that we bring to your altar this day with your love. Send them forth into the world that they may reveal your presence for all to see. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Please remain standing for our gospel reading. I'll be reading from the gospel according to Mark, chapter 15, verses 15 through 23, and you can find that on page 885 in your pew Bible if you would like to follow along. Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released for them Barabbas, and having scourged Jesus, he delivered him to be crucified. And the soldiers led him away inside the palace, that is, the praetorium, and they called together the whole battalion. And they clothed him in a purple cloak, and plaiting a crown of thorns, they put it on him. And they began to salute him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they struck his head with a reed and spat upon him, and they knelt down in homage to him. And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him, and they led him out to crucify him. They compelled a passerby, Simon of Cyrene, who was coming in from the country, the father of Alexander and Rufus, to carry his cross. And they brought him to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of a skull. And they offered him wine mingled with myrrh, but he did not take it. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. This morning, I'd like us to linger a bit on the last hours before Jesus' crucifixion, trying to understand more clearly the torture he underwent and what it might say about our own lives as we seek to follow him. The flagrum, or whip, was made of leather, braided with bits of stone, metal, glass, bone, or other sharp objects specifically designed to tear as well as bruise the flesh. One variation of the whip, called the scorpion, had nail-like talons even more efficient at tearing the flesh from bone. The soldiers decided that their freshly robed king needed a crown, and so they twisted a branch from a thorn tree into a rough oval that parried the royal laurel wreath, as we see on our cross here. Then they pressed it down onto his brow in mock coronation, so the thorns dug into his flesh. They shouted, "Hail, King of the Jews!" and saluted him. It is in this moment that we get that clear and tragic glimpse of what humanity did when God took on flesh and walked among us. Jesus could have destroyed them all with a word, but instead he bore the shame and humiliation, in part so all who came after him could learn from his story something about the human condition and about the costliness of God's grace. We ask ourselves why the soldiers did these things. Why did they torture him? Why did they humiliate him? This man had loved lost people. He had preached the good news of the kingdom of God. He had healed the sick. He had opened the eyes of the blind. Of course, he had also challenged the authority of the religious leaders and pointed out their hypocrisy. What kind of men were these? In every part of this story, we have met people who did things that are difficult to imagine. The Sanhedrin demanding that Jesus be put to death. The crowd crying out for him to be crucified. Pontius Pilate sentencing him to satisfy the crowd. And then the Roman soldiers taking delight in tearing the flesh from his bones and then spitting on him and humiliating him. Were all these hundreds of soldiers evil? Or did their role as occupiers in a foreign land, their constant awareness of the desires of the locals to be rid of them, bring out this inhumanity. You know, we can sit back after the fact and say, I could never do that. I could never have been one of those Roman soldiers that took delight in mocking and lashing and terrorizing an innocent man. But we need to be careful about those claims we make. Think about other times in history when innocent people suffered under the oppression of the authority. One example that comes to mind, have you ever wondered what was so different about the Germans of the 30s and 40s? Were they so unlike present-day Americans such as you and me? Why were so many ordinary people willing to kill their Jewish neighbors under certain circumstances? You know, ordinary people can be persuaded to do extraordinary and awful things, given the right combination of ideology, authority, and gradual desensitization. All of us can become monsters capable of destroying other people with weapons ranging from words to gas chambers. It's a reality that we need to face and guard against, looking instead to God and trying to understand who God has called us to be. Making Jesus carry the cross on which he would be crucified gave the Romans one more opportunity to inflict humiliation and emotional pain on him. In contrast to John's account, Matthew, Mark, and Luke tell us Simon of Cyrene carried the cross. The two versions are not difficult to reconcile when we imagine Jesus carrying the beam for a few hundred yards until his dehydrated and physically weakened condition just left him unable to go on. Have any of you ever carried a cross like that? In one town I lived in, on Good Friday, we'd meet at the library and we'd carry the cross all the way to the recreational field. We'd take turns and we'd walk as a group carrying that cross. It usually needed more than one person. It was very, very heavy. Cyrene was a city in northern Libya, and Simon was probably a Jew visiting Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover when he was pressed into service. Just walking by. As he and Jesus neared Golgotha, or perhaps as they arrived at the site, someone offered Jesus that glass of wine mixed with myrrh. Now listen to this, though. It is believed that myrrh served as an analgesic, something to deaden the pain. So this might have been an act of compassion intended to help numb him to the worst part of the agony, a piece that we don't realize because we don't know really what myrrh is, that we learn by studying. Again, this is the second time myrrh is mentioned in the Gospels. And Jesus' mother Mary was there watching this take place, and seeing that gesture, she would have remembered the scene in which it was first mentioned when those magi brought the gifts to the babe, when the myrrh was presented to her son after his birth. It was a curious gift for the magi to bring, but now, just now, she understands it as prophetic. Now, Jesus has had nothing to eat or drink since the Last Supper, but he refused the offer of a painkiller. Just another way that he bore the pain for us. Jesus knew what was ahead, and he was not going to deaden the pain with drugs. Christians believe, and Jesus clearly taught, that his suffering and death were the means of salvation for humanity. Through them, men and women would be offered forgiveness, redemption, and right standing with God. Now, the subjective or moral influence theory of the atonement maintains the atonement was not about changing God or making it possible for God to forgive us. It was rather about changing you and me. Jesus' suffering, death, and resurrection constitute a divine drama that's meant to communicate God's word to humanity, to make clear to us our need for redemption and forgiveness, to show us the full extent of God's love and lead us to repentance. John's gospel begins with a prologue in which he speaks of Jesus as God's word. Jesus was God's vehicle for communicating with us, his word made flesh. In Jesus, God's divine nature was united with human flesh to reveal his character, his love, and his will for humanity. What was God trying to say in the suffering and the death of Jesus? In these events that we've talked about surrounding the last 24 hours of Jesus' life on earth, they speak first of the brokenness of humanity. And as we've seen already, each of the persons that take part in this tragedy are reflections of that brokenness. The disciples fell asleep, and they fled in fear as Jesus was arrested. Judas betrayed Jesus. Peter denied him. The Sanhedrin wished him to be dead. The crowds preferred a Messiah preaching violence to a Messiah preaching love. And the governor wished to satisfy the crowd, and the soldiers took delight in torturing, dehumanizing an innocent man. This story of what human beings did when God walked among us is an indictment of humanity. We are meant to find ourselves in that story and to be moved by its tragic end. We're meant to realize there is something deeply wrong with us, that we are broken, that we are in need of forgiveness. I don't know if any of you have had the opportunity to visit the National Holocaust Museum, the one in D.C. Maybe you've been to one in another place. I've been there twice. And I would say it's probably the most exhaustive museum I've ever been to. And I've been fortunate enough to go to a lot of museums in my lifetime. When I say exhaustive, I'm not talking about the size of the museum or the time it takes to go through it. I'm talking about the emotions of reliving the experience through the photos and stories and the shoes and the clothing and all the different things of that period in time. Realizing that it wasn't just Hitler, but the Holocaust is an indictment upon the entire human race. And realizing that even as a professing Christian, I could have been put in a concentration camp and gassed. Because I was a quarter Jew, or I'm a quarter Jew, I guess that's what you say. My grandparents on my dad's side were Jewish. And it listed all the ways that you would have been, all the connections that have caused you to be caught That first visit and the second, looking at it again, was very enlightening to that whole time in history. And that's what that museum's about, to affect visitors so deeply that they leave committed to a proposition that this should never happen again. In the same way, this theory of the atonement that suggests that the suffering and death of Christ are meant to affect deeply those who hear the story. Jesus' suffering and death are intended to be a mirror held up to our souls, a reminder of the jealousy, pettiness, self-centeredness, spiritual blindness, and darkness that lurks in all our souls. We are meant to read the gospel accounts of this torture and humiliation and crucifixion of Christ and say, never again. God, save us from ourselves. Lord, have mercy upon us. The accounts are to move us to repentance. Jesus' suffering and death were not accidental. He chose the path he knew would end in his passion. He faced the whip, the crown, and the cross with determination, silence, and dignity. He stood naked as if to say, do you see the extent of the Father's love yet? Do you understand that I have come so that you might finally hear of a love that is willing to suffer, even to die, in order to win you over? Sacrificial love transforms enemies into friends, shames the guilty into repentance, and melts hearts of stone. The world is changed by true demonstrations of sacrificial love and by selfless acts of service. We are to look at the cross of Jesus and say, I have to strive to live in such a way as to be worthy of that sacrifice. We are meant to be changed by this and in turn practice sacrificial love towards others. And as each new follower of Jesus practices such love, the world will be changed and humanity transformed. Amen. Let us stand for our closing hymn. Benediction. Go forth in peace. God has written love on our hearts. Christ has revealed love in our world. The Spirit sends us forth to share this glorious message of love with everyone we meet. Amen.